which came to us that we are burning beyond measure, above strength, so that we are despaired even of life. Yes, we had a sentence of death in ourselves, and we should not trust in ourselves in God who raised the dead. In other words, Paul is talking about their suffering to the point of death. So sometimes we go through things and then we say, is it just me? Am I the only Christian? It's like, you know, it's like when we are suffering to the point that it's like, you know, it's like unto death. For instance, you know, we lose some loved ones, and then, you know, we are saying to ourselves, why are we going through this? And we have some financial problems, we have all kinds of things. But you know, God says he's going to deliver us from so great a death and thus deliver us. As long as we trust in him, that he will still deliver us. So that's what Paul is talking. He's making a contrast. He's making contrast and comparison in that 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Just reading from verse 4 to that verse 10 down there. So this 1 Corinthians, let me read verse 4 again. No, now back to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, then we have a building from God. Yeah. A house not made with hand, eternal in the heaven. Then Paul is sure, he said, we know this. He said that if this our earthly house, this tent, so this body of us, Paul is calling it a tent. That is a tent.
Amen.
This let me share this earthly house.
Earthly house.
It's an empty house.
Earthly house.
So it's a tent.
Let
me hear it's a tent.
Tent.
It's a tent. That's what Paul calls it. It's a tent. Look, when people of Israel were going from Egypt to the promised land, for those 40 years, they did not stay in a brick building. You are staying in tents. Because what does tent signify? It's temporary. Just temporary. So this thing that we have, God said, it's a tent. It's a temporary abode. For instance, yesterday we went to, was it yesterday? Yeah, yesterday Pastor Stacks was ministering at this funeral service. I think Sister Cassandra's relative. Something. So he was, Pastor was ministering down there and was using John chapter 14 as base of his ministry to us, that, you know, said in my father's house there are a lot of mansions, you know, that God has gone to prepare a place. So was telling us, but because what we have right here is temporary. But in that verse one, it says we have a building. Let me say building.
Building.
So let me build from God a house. See, that one is a house, not made with hands, eternally in heaven. In other words, what God is taking us, this body is going to be changed.
Right.
And then the other one, he didn't call that one a tent, he said it's a building. But not only is it a building, because this is a building too, but this building, this one, they are going to destroy. Because this building is made of earthly materials. But it says that building, that verse says that building is made, it says not made with hands. So it's not made with our hands. It's not made with this type of things. Although it's a building, it's better than a tent. But this one is still going to work, to be destroyed. Just like God told the people of Israel, and Jesus was telling them, before he died, said, see, this building, said, it's going to be destroyed. And he was talking about his body, but they did not understand it. Because he thought he was talking about, for 3 days, it's going to be cast down, and in 3 days, it will rise again. Then he said, the temple was talking about temple. The temple still went down too, though, because that temple was destroyed.
Right.
Our body that is made of a building from God is not going to be destroyed. Because we cannot take this body to heaven.
That's right.
It's not made for heaven.
Right.
Because Pastor Osiris said, over there, said, yesterday was saying that, Fuller said, the way there we know There's a lot of things here. They said, we don't need this house down here for over there.
That's right.
Don't need that. God has prepared something different.
Yes.
And the only way we can partake of that, this thing is going to be 3 months. The only way we can partake of that is to start preparing right now.
Amen.
Right now. Don't worry about your situation. Don't worry about your husband, your wife. But sometimes, as married couple, we're thinking, for that wife of mine, if only God can just change her. And what I'm saying, if only God can just change it. But the prayer should pray that God change me to deal with my partner. So don't be telling God, God, who's going to take her, Lord? No, tell God to change you. If he changes you, then you can deal with what God is giving you to do.
Amen.
Because we are preparing for a better place. And it's not made with hands. It's not made with hands. It's something that God has prepared. And that's why even Christ has to go first, drop that earthly body that he acquired through Mary, that can have a body, you know, his own glorious body. So, and then we are looking forward to that glorious body. So, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 5. It should be more, look, although I call it a walk by faith, but it should be called something like that. How do we face death? How do we face it? That's another title I'm giving to this talk. How do we face death? How do we do it? And that's why, you know, it's always good to go to funerals. When you go to funerals, you go in there, for instance, yesterday, all I have to do is just stand myself, because there was no room for me to sit. There were a lot of people standing all the way to the adjacent hall outside. Was just filled up. I said, this man must know so many people. And I see a rainbow of people, black, white, or Spanish. I said, okay, this man must have struck enough or something for all these type of people to be there. And that congregation yesterday was reminding me of what we are going to meet when we go to heaven.
Amen.
Because every time people in there, so, see, is this man black? Is he white? I don't even know, because I don't know him. But I said, oh, this man was so full of life. Was say, where is he? Because at that time, it's us that we are talking to. We are talking to ourselves, and then we are crying, and not for the one that is gone, but for ourselves. How do we face death when we live here? This world is everything. What are they going to write about us? That's what I should be thinking about. Are they going to be saying he loved the Lord so much? And they're going to say, he's a party animal. So what are you going to tell us? Do we love the world or do we love God? It's one of the two.
Amen.
But people tell us what we'll tell when we are gone. Oh, that guy, oh, he's the life of the party. How about with Jesus?
Amen.
So that's where we should be.
That's right.
And that's what we are talking about in this 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So, look, let me stay a little bit on that verse 1. That verse 1 is going to do all kinds of stuff.
Rich.
Yeah, it's very rich, you know. I was going to clarify that. But I can't get off it. So he's talking about, it's a heavenly house. It's a spiritual body. It's a house which comes from God. Almost like that, we say, it's a spiritual body, it's a house that comes from God. It's a house not made with hands. It's eternal in heaven. The comparison of the body to the house or the place of the spirit, of course, is natural and common enough. But the earthly house is called a tent. So that earthly house, this body of ours is a tent. So, this person, we know that if our earthly house, this tent is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house, not made with hands, eternal in heaven. This is how Christians handle death. In fact, this is the only way to face it, knowing that when this earthly body is destroyed, there is another body, a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in heaven. That's something that we need to keep looking forward to, you know, that we have something that we are looking forward to. We have this spiritual body that we are going to get. And that's where Christ does show a glimpse. He showed a glimpse to the three inner circles. Peter, James, and John. He took them and for a minute, that ending thing of Christ was changed to a dazzling, glorious body, and they saw the beholding, they saw the glory of God. And Brother Peter, you know what just said? Hey, let's be there permanently. Why get away from here? Let us build something here and just stay here permanently. But they saw that glory, and they were so, you know, they were excited. And that glorious body that we are looking forward to, when Christ rose, and then the few days that he stayed in this world, he went through talking to whoever that was just to meet. Like Peter went and restored Peter at that time. He went and he went to the disciples. He went to the room and he asked Thomas, "Touch me, you know, I'm still in one." He ate something with them. He did all kind of stuff. So we're just looking forward to that glorious body, because we cannot be in heaven without a body. We are going to be in one form of the body or the other one. Because this world is going to, this day is going to be, you know, it's dead, it's dust. It's going to go down to the dust. And then we are going to just be clothed with the new one. So when a Christian dies, you know, it's a glorious time.
Amen.
Nobody wants to say, "I want to go right now," because we still have some things to do.
Amen.
But when we live as Christians, and that's why the Son of God said, we must live by faith. See, you must live by faith and not by sight. Because when we live by faith, then we're able to fulfill what God has called us to do. We're able to just live on his narrow path and just glorify him every minute of our life. So a tent is a temporary habitation of a traveler. A building is a permanent habitation of a rescue. The body will now occupy. The building is the glorious body we are designed to occupy. As long as we walk by faith. As long as we do what we walk by faith. We have to walk by faith to be able to get hold of that. Because, you know, look, if you're a Christian and you don't have sorrows and stuff, then you need to go and check yourself. But even Brother Paul said, I'm sorrowing every minute. If you look at the resume of Brother Paul, it's all sorrow. The beat him up, says he died, almost died. He's a shipwreck. And everybody rejected him. So if you're a Christian and everything is rosy right now, and you think there's no sorrow in this life and stuff like that, yes, as Christians, you know, Christ is going to be there and help us to go through stuff. But if you are saying you don't even have anything to, you know, nothing at all in your life, then you need to check yourself, are you living right?
Amen.
And if you don't, you can come to me, I can give you some of these things that because I have a bunch of it. I can borrow you some. I was telling Pastor, was it on Thursday? I said, I went to LA Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday this week. Last week, it's not last week. Then on Friday, I said, I'm going to LA again. He said, I pray for God, give the increase. Because he knows I'm struggling with something. If not, I'm not going to be driving to LA every day. But now I'm strong, and his prayer was, God will give you the increase.
Amen.
And I just thank God for his life, for, you know, for just giving that, you know. See, sometimes the best prayer you pray is to us, you know. Yep. Help me! Help! God, help! The best prayer you pray sometimes. God, help! Or, they said, Brother Kevin is in charge of getting some houses and stuff, you know, he's a big guy. And then I want to go to his office and go, God, help me. This man, God, give me favor. So I'm praying as I'm going to his stuff, and I smile. Because I'm looking for favor. Then I tell God, and I'm putting the best demeanor up, say, okay. So when, because I don't want God to open his favor door for me, and my flesh is messing it up. Mm-hmm. So as soon as he knows that, I smile. Hey, brother. Okay, all right. You can have a seat. So the favor door is open already.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
So that's what this chapter is telling us. Let's go say we must be doing that to walk by faith. Let me see what Philippians chapter 3 verses 20 and 21 says. Philippians chapter 3 verses 20 and 21. Philippians 3 verses 20 and 21. Because now we are dead bound right now, but we need to be heavenly bound.
Amen.
We need to be heavenly bound. We need to understand. That's why no matter what the sorrow and everything we are going through, don't worry about it. Jesus is in the midst of it. Just like he was in the midst of his disciples, they were in the rocking boat. You know, the boat was rocking. And Christ was down there in that boat asleep. And that's what happens to us sometimes. We are going through things and say, God, where are you? The people always say, God, where are you? God is always where he was. He's always there. The same God yesterday, today, and forever. He will never change. It's we. The Bible says, I look up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from God. He's always down there looking at us. When the people of Israel, when they were in bondage for a long time, for all that time, like they were in affliction, they were there. God did not send Moses to go and relieve them because they are good people. They are terrible set of people. When we have this flesh, we are all terrible. The Bible says, there's no one that is righteous, not no one.
Amen.
God told Moses, said, my people are down there in Egypt, and they'll be crying unto me, and I've heard their cry. I don't know what you are going through. If you don't take it to God and cry to him, you may be in that situation for a long time. You may be there for a long, long time. Not that God does not do, he knows everything. He has power to do anything. But until you cry to him.
Amen.
If you want to learn how to cry to God, study some of those Psalms. In the book of Psalms.
Yeah.
So like David said, I'm crying to you, Lord. Change this situation. So this let me get back to this Philippians chapter 3. Verse 20 to 21 says, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Our citizenship is not of this world,
it's
in heaven. In verse 21 says, Jesus Christ, he will transform our lowly body that he may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. So, this body of ours, Christ is going to change it. And we are waiting to say, our citizenship is in heaven. When somebody is doing some nasty things to you, just comfort yourself that I am a child of authority.
Amen.
Let me say that. Say, I am a child of authority.
Listen,
I am a child of authority. One more time. I am a child of authority. When somebody is doing something that's like the nasty, I'm a child of authority. The Bible says we are kings and queens.
Amen.
So just hold on to that.
Amen.
So when that thing is coming, relationship, husband and wife, parents and children, I say, God, I am a king on this side of heaven.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I am a child of the covenant.
Yes.
I can do all things.
Amen.
This thing that I'm going through, it just came, it's going to pass. Bible says it came to pass.
Yes.
But you keep telling God your father, you keep crying to God. And guess what? That thing will be done.
Amen.
It's going to change because we are waiting.
That's right.
While we are waiting, we are still kingdom people.
Amen.
And that's why God remembered the people of Israel. Because they are people of covenant.
Amen.
Why did God pick them and not pick the Egyptians? I don't have the answer. Because they are all messed up.
Right.
The Egyptians were messed up. The people of Israel were messed up. Moses was over there to get some Ten Commandments before he came down. The only side was in idols.
Right.
So you see that they are good people. Nobody is good.
Right.
Because no one. No one is good.
Right.
But we must be living by faith.
Yes.
So that we can have this new body.
Amen.
We must be walking towards, because look, if money can buy, oh, I don't know, people would deploy some money and go, okay, I can do this content. You know, with a half, how much does it cost? 1 million? I work one million, I can give God an extra. Maybe I'll give him 1 million and some change. People work towards that, I'm telling you. People will do anything if it costs money. It doesn't cost money. Christ gave, he gave himself for us. It does not cost us anything.
Right.
It costs God everything.
Yeah. Amen.
It costs him his only son.
Yes.
Salvation is free. Because we cannot buy, we cannot work for it.
Amen.
But we must get it. We must walk towards it. We must hold on to Christ. We must every minute of our life be walking towards that level. We must be living by faith. It's not by sight.
Amen.
He must just be letting us know that, yes, I know where I'm going. Unless I've done the book of Revelation, it paints a picture about heaven. So, yeah, I'm going to that place of gold, so, you know, nice, so, you know, everything that I don't have down here. There's no sorrow, there's no crying, there's no. See, when you keep reading all that, and then, you know, you start getting goosebumps.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Like we are going somewhere.
Yes.
But now is the time to walk for it. This is the time to walk. It's now.
That's right.
The Bible says today is the day of salvation.
Yes.
It's not tomorrow.
That's right.
Because when you witness to some people, sometimes you witness to some people and say, okay, come back next week. We'll talk more about it. So when anybody is telling you to come back, always let them know that today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
Salvation is not for tomorrow. It's not for next week. It's not because you can be waiting for next week, and next week may not come.
Amen.
But today, you have it.
Hallelujah.
So today, when you witness it to somebody, please always remember that. Just push them, just push the little, you know, especially when they're almost ready. Paul said, when he was preaching to the gospel, Paul said, I wish, to that one, he said, Saint Paul, you almost made me to be a believer. You almost made me to cross over. And Paul said, I wish everybody would not only be in that position, but they would also cross over to you.
Right.
They wanted everybody that is talking to cross over to Jesus.
Amen.
And that should be what we are doing.
Right.
We need to let other people know that, yes, what you are going through, the Bible says, cast all cares on him because he cares for you.
Amen.
It says, he's going to help us to walk that new life.
Amen.
Says, that whole body of us is going to be a dump. And then we're going to have a new life, a new body.
Amen.
So why we have that? When we have baptism, in baptism, everything that you have done, when you do water baptism, is a symbol. That everything we have done so far went down and died with Christ.
Amen.
And then when he rises up from the water, so now we have the newness of life.
Yes.
So it's just a symbol. But the most important one when we get baptized is a spiritual baptism.
Amen.
When the Holy Spirit now comes to you, the Holy Spirit will now come and start showing you this is the way. When we go that way, we say, no, no, go this way.
Amen.
And if you don't go that way, then God will chastise you again. That next time, when you just go this way, you will know.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? So we are sheep.
Right.
Sheep are very, very, very stubborn, very, very nasty sometimes.
Right.
So we are sheep. And that's why we do something, God will chastise us, we do it again. So we're always in the house of affliction,
right.
And then God will chastise us again. Guess what? We do it again.
That's right.
Because we're sheep.
Right.
We're sheep. And then sometimes now we get heavy things. You know, we are heavy with all that stuff that we are kind enough. And that's why, like sheep, you know, sheep, you have to shear them, right? Get all that extra wool out of them. That's what we do too as human beings, you know. We are the sheep, we have all this extra stuff that we don't need to go there to cut out.
Amen.
Like he can be freer. And we are just be moving with this world.
Amen.
But we thank God for Jesus that is a shepherd.
Yeah.
The Bible says, the Lord is my shepherd, I will not lack anything.
Amen.
Because we are sheep. And as long as my people know me, they hear my voice. As long as you know the voice of Christ, Although we are teaching, they will follow you. That's the good thing about it.
Yeah.
You know. And that's why Christ loved us. Because he gave himself for us. And his people said, he said, if one of us were to miss and start walking the wrong way, he would lead the rest of us and say, and go after that one. Just one. Then you go after him. So it does not matter what you are going through, Christ is going to be there for you, to bring you back to full. He will always bring you back to full. It does not matter where you are from. As long as you go back to him and do a 360 turn around and tell God, I'm sorry.
Amen.
God, I'm sorry for what I've done.
Amen.
Maybe you are messing up with your family like that. You go to God and say, God, I'm sorry for messing up with my family, because sometimes we are not even terrorizing people outside. We are terrorizing the people inside our own family.
Amen.
Go to God, say, Lord, I'm sorry. And as men and women, please let us have listening ears. Because sometimes we don't listen.
Amen.
We are so stuck up in our ways.
Amen.
And when a loved one starts telling you, oh, brothers, don't do this, or sisters, don't do that, say, oh, no, you don't understand. But you don't know me. I don't operate that way. That's pride. That's pride. You need to understand. You need to just be walking, you know, the way that Christ wants us to walk. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go to verse 2. And then in this verse 2, he says, For in this thing, says, we groan, desiring to be clothed with our habitation which is from heaven. Says, we groan in this body. Says, we groan. Let me hear you say, groan.
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 Groan to the throne.
Mr. Kamaleta was down there earlier today. She was setting up all these things for us. And all of a sudden, said, oh, she was groaning. It's a very good example. She was groaning because this time, you know, so the older you get, you start groaning.
Exactly.
You wake up and like, oh, man. You know, you sit down for a minute and then goes, oh, God help you. We groan. And then, look, it's okay to groan. That's what the Bible says. So, the older we get.
That's speaking in tongues. That's an unknown tongue.
Yeah. A friend of mine, he turned 50, then he called me and said, wow, I saw him. Said, my body, I don't know where this body came from. I said, just turned 50. Because when he started running. Then he said, I wonder what's going to happen when I turn 60. When the same man turns 60, oh, then he said, I'm going to the hospital. He said, I don't know what is in this project. So he's, you know, he's just, he's a 50, you know, he's just saying, the older he gets, he's going to grow some more. And he's, you know, we grow to the throne.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. And indeed, if having the clothed, we shall not be found naked. Uh-huh. He says, we need to be clothed. See, what I'm saying, we need to be clothed with that, with that new body that we are looking forward to.
Amen.
So we need to be clothed with that.
Amen.
And how do we get clothed that? With righteousness.
Yeah.
With holy things.
Amen.
With taking corrections. With knowing that, you know, the person that is standing to terrorize your house is not your husband, it's not your wife.
Right.
Or sometimes say, oh, it's my wife. If I can only do blah, 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 oh, it's my husband. No, that husband of mine, I don't even know what I'm going to do with him. It's a lie, because the enemy is down there, you know, taking advantage of whatever little door that you have opened.
Amen.
But you are, look, they turned out, they did 30 years of marriage. They talked about some good things, some not so good things. Then you talk about the first year. The first year we'll be looking at, oh man, is this a Kassan American? Kabaneta don't come home. Maybe, you know, I can't even sleep. So when they first started, you know, all those good stuff, you know, after a while, after a period of time, you know, it's running down. But love is changing in the new dimension.
Yes,
sir. is changing. It's changing to a more agape love. But the more we stay together, the more we say, I don't find anything in common with this guy. How do you get married to Saul? But the more you say, wait a minute, we are complete opposites. I don't know why that always happens in marriages. We are complete opposites. And guess what? You see, you are still there because the Holy Spirit is helping you.
Amen.
We are loving each other. When we start loving each other, you may be more afraid of physical attraction.
That's right.
Then more years go by, then the Holy Spirit starts to just giving you that new covenant, that new body preparing you. And then you start loving that person in a different light.
Amen.
And then it's because what he's talking about in that verse 3 says, that having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. Having been clothed with righteousness, we shall not be found naked with unrighteousness. Let me tell you one thing that happened with that being clothed with righteousness. It started right here from the garden.
Yes.
It started from the garden. Adam and Eve, they were clothed with righteousness. Everything was rosy for them. Everything that they need was down there. Then all of a sudden, the enemy came in and tripped them. So they messed up. Then God now comes in, because God comes in every day in the pool of him and says, hey Adam, how was it there? What happened? And then when God came in that day, they went and did what? They hid themselves.
Mm.
And they goes, Adam, where are you? Oh Lord, I'm down here, I'm naked. Now, because they have gone from righteousness to unrighteousness. No, now they are not clothed unrighteousness.
Mm.
And guess what? We've been doing that ever since.
Amen.
It's easier to get clothed in unrighteousness. It's more difficult to get clothed in righteousness. But today's topic is telling us that we must live by faith.
Amen.
Not by sight. Because when we are clothing ourselves with that righteousness, we are getting ourselves prepared for that new body that we are going to endure.
Amen.
That's what I was talking about in that verse 3. In verse 4 said, for we who are in this tent grown, being body, we want to be unclothed, but for that clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. The person that has prepared for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So the moment we come to Christ, and Christ has lived inside us, that deposit of the Holy Spirit is there. Because once Christ is there, the Holy Spirit is there. God said, I'm going to leave you the Comforter.
Yes.
Christ told us he will give us the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. The Paraclete that is going to show us all the things, that is going to guide us and direct us the right ways. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
And that's why I said he has given us that guarantee. He has given us the guarantee. Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 23. Let me see what that says. Romans 8, verse 23. Let me turn to That Romans 8:23 is talking about the Holy Spirit as a deposit. So it's not only that, but we also have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves grow within ourselves, eagerly awaiting the adoption of the redemption of our body. So this body of ours, we are awaiting it with groaning. That is, we are groaning to the throne. But we are awaiting it because The first, you know, I told you guys about the first fruit the other time. The first fruit is this Holy Spirit right now. Because he's preparing us. And we are eagerly awaiting that. So But God is not going to leave us comfortless. He's going to be there for us. He's not going to leave us to be doing it by ourselves. Amen?
Amen.
And he said in verse 7, we are always confident knowing that while we are at home in this body, we are absent from the Lord. The while we are away from this, well, from this body, we are absent from the Lord. And therefore we walk by faith. Because while we are down here, in this body, we are absent from God. Said to be Paul went further and says in verse 8 said, we are confident, yes, we are well pleased. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So when we are absent from this tent, then we are present with God. So that's what I'm saying. Today's message is good to take to friends services. You know, it's good to just to encourage ourselves about this growing, about this body, that once we are on the right of what God wants us to do, is getting us prepared to a place that is promised us. Because he said, says the way he said, we know the place.
Amen.
And we know the place.
Right.
And then to know the place is to be walking towards it.
Amen.
And that's why he said in that verse 7, says, we walk by faith, not by sight. So we have to be walking by faith. That's where I'm going.
Amen.
This is what I have to do.
Yes.
All these are big things, all these things I'm carrying with me as a sheep. I need, you know, God to help me to take it off.
Amen.
So I can be light. I can be light and go to where I'm supposed to go.
Amen.
When we have all those things that we are committing, all those things that we are doing that weighing us down, we need to get rid of them. And each person is different. Everybody knows what we have to do to get rid of some of this weight. This weight that is snares us. We need to just get rid of it.
Amen.
And be able to just walk with Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Want to look at one more verse and then we'll close. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 42 to 49. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. That will run the first. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 42 to 49. Talking about the body that we are looking forward to. That's what he's talking about. I'm going to just start it from the middle of verse 42. It says, are you there?
Yes.
It says, in the resurrection of the dead, the body is sown in corruption, is raised in incorruption. See, this body, he's talking about this body of ours, this tent. It says, is sown in corruption, because it's going to die. But it's raised in incorruption. Going to be a better one. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. That's why we are growing. But it is raised in power. It is sown as a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. Then there is a natural body and then there is a spiritual body. The natural body is this thing. The spiritual body is the one that God is building without that is building by himself, not with our hands. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, and the last man, a life-giving spirit. So the first man is Adam, and then the last one is Jesus.
Amen.
However, the spiritual is not the first, but the natural. And after all, the spiritual. The first man was of the earth. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven.
Amen.
As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. Verse 49. And as we are born the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man.
Amen.
So what's it say? The first man, Adam, he gave us all these things that we inherit. It's like our names are in two books, if I can just summarize it. If you come to this world, you have the same of Adam embedded in you. Every one of us, no exception, except Jesus Christ that came without any sin. So we are all descendants of Adam. We all have that sin that we came to this world with. And Christ now came, he shed his blood on Calvary, and then he has a new book. It's the book of life. So if your name, if you come to this world naturally from Adam, all that stuff, and your name is not written in Lamb's book, then that person is in trouble. But when we come through everything that we heard here from Adam, with all the saints, everything that's in there, the day that we confess Christ,
amen,
the day that we say Christ is my Lord and Savior, that is the day that we become born again.
Amen.
And that's why Christ was there, Nicodemus said, to get this new body that he's talking about, said, you must be born again.
Amen.
And Nicodemus does not understand that. And God is talking to all of us today. We must be born again so that our names can be written in the book of life.
Amen.
And then we can look forward to that new point that he's talking about in this 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We have to have the bear image of the heavenly man. And that heavenly man is Christ. And that's what we need to be working towards. Working towards that. Was believing by faith, not by sight.
Amen.
All the sorrows, everything that we are going through at this time, don't worry about it. Just ask God, grow to Christ.
Amen.
Ask Christ to help you. To help you. To help each one of us. And then when we cry to him, he has a solution for that problem. We may think we do have a solution, but we don't. We don't have a problem. We don't have a solution. Until we cry to Christ. And then by the time we saw that problem, oh, that was so easy. But it wasn't easy when we're dealing with the process. So let's stand up and just pray and just thank God for what he saw.